Hey guys, it's Alex with Engineering Applied. We're going to be accelerating your career, hobby, or business with this overview of the available 2D sketch format options found within Autodesk Inventor. If you want more easy to understand and practical content created by an experienced engineer like myself, make sure you like this video, subscribe to the channel, and turn on notifications so you don't miss out on any helpful content that's going to help you along your journey. Also, don't forget to check the description for timestamps if you're looking for a particular function. And if you don't find what you're looking for in this video, by all means, check out my Autodesk Inventor tutorial series playlist because I'm confident you'll find exactly what you're looking for. Let's get started. Okay, so to start this lesson, we're going to be taking a look at the construction geometry formatting option. So what this will allow us to do is it allows us to create reference geometry or elements that the software allows us to position other actual elements off of, but it doesn't take these construction elements into account when adding or removing 3D bodies or geometry in our model. So to illustrate this for you, we're going to be taking a look at this disc here. So first, we're going to go ahead and cut a hole in the center of this disc. So to do this, we can just draw a circle. And the size of the circle doesn't really matter in this particular example. We'll just leave it there. But you'll notice this is a regular element, which it has a solid line. And if we were to go create a cut here, you'll notice that it recognizes that circular profile and it cuts a hole through the center of this disc. However, if I were to change this to construction geometry, it behaves differently. So if I go back in that sketch, I'll go ahead and change this to construction geometry. And I'm going to take a little detour here to tell you that a few different ways to change this to construction geometry. So there's three ways you could do this. The first way is you can select the already drawn regular element, go up to format and construction. You click that and it'll change to a dashed line. This represents a construction element. The second way you can do this is you can right click on the profile, go over to construction in your marking menu, and then you could left click. So you have it there as construction. And lastly, what you could do is if you click out in 3D space or just deselect any tools that you're working in, you can also hit escape a couple times. That's what I typically do. And if you pre-select construction and then go to whatever element you want to drop, you'll notice it automatically defaults to construction elements. This is really helpful when you're dropping a lot of reference geometry back to back and you don't want to individually change them after the fact. So you could certainly do it this way as well. So we're going to remove those and I'm going to go ahead and change this to construction geometry again. Now, if we go to cut a hole in the center, look what happens. So you'll notice that the software doesn't recognize that circle as usable geometry for this particular application. And that's because, again, this is a construction element. The software doesn't recognize this as something it can use to add or take away 3D geometry. This element exists so that we can use it to dimension other elements off of it, use it as some other sort of visual reference for our design effort. So I'll show you an actual example of how we can combine regular elements and construction elements to fulfill an end goal. Okay, so I have my disc here and I went ahead and put a center point rectangle where it's centered with the origin of the sketch plane. And you'll notice that this is our construction element because it has the dashed lines. And then I went ahead and drew four circles, which are regular elements because they're solid lines at each corner of the rectangle. So our objective here is to use this square reference element to position these four circles for a hole pattern that we want to make in this disc. Now, what you'll notice is that when we jump out of this sketch and go to extrude and go to create a cut, you'll notice that it'll recognize these circles, you know, and we hover over it, it turns green and we could click on these spaces. But it doesn't recognize the square that we drew in the sketch. And this is that big distinction between the sketch element and the regular element. And this is a specific case in which you would see the particular use of this element itself. So it's a really handy tool. I use this all the time in my sketches when I'm trying to position various elements. but I don't want it to show up or be recognized when I'm ready to create or remove 3D geometry. The next formatting option is the driven dimension option. And what this does is it toggles a dimension's ability to actually drive the sketch geometry, which means if I were to change this dimension here to something else, it would actually drive change geometrically in the sketch and in the model. But a driven dimension is the exact opposite. It's a reference dimension that is driven off of the geometry and the other geometrical factors that are already constrained. So, for example, let's say I wanted to know the length between the origin and the center point of this circle here. So what I can do is I can create a dimension from the origin and from the center point, drop it somewhere. But notice, before I drop this, you'll notice that our sketch is currently fully defined. When you have a fully defined sketch, this is what happens. You'll get a little dialog box that says, hey, you're about to over-constrain the sketch, and we're going to go ahead and default this dimension as a driven dimension, or a reference dimension, so that it doesn't over-constrain anything. So if we click accept, you'll see that it parenthesizes the dimension. So what this means is, hey, this is a driven dimension. It's here for visual reference only, but it's not actually changing the sketch or the model itself. So if I were to change this to something else, you'll notice that this dimension changed. But if I go to change this, I can't actually edit anything because it's not driving the sketch geometry like these regular dimensions are. Now, what you could also do is you could take an existing dimension, so let's say 0.150 here, and we can click the dimension and go up to driven dimension, and you'll notice our sketch is no longer fully defined because it's treating this dimension, which was positioning the holes horizontally, as reference only. So now what we could do is if we wanted to control this by the diagonal length, we can drop this, and now we can actually change this dimension. So if we were to change this to 0.125, it'll actually drive that geometrical change from this dimension. And then this just tells us, hey, this length happens to be 0.200, but this dimension is not really factoring into the positioning of anything. So that's what your driven dimension is. Let's take a look at the center line format option. So essentially what a center line does for us is it creates a relation between two mirrored elements with reference to their separation. So let me illustrate this for you here. I'm gonna drop just a regular line first. So we'll just do a vertical line. And our objective here is that we want to mirror this rectangle to the other side and then revolve it around the center line. So you'll notice we have a regular line element. It's a solid line. We'll go up to the center line option. And now it creates an irregularly dashed line. So this signifies a center line. Take note, this is not a construction line. So if I were to change this to a construction line, it's a uniformly dashed line with the little dash marks on there. So let's go ahead and change that back to a center line. And we'll go ahead and mirror this rectangle over this mirror line. Okay, so we have our mirrored profile. Now, let's say we want to set the separation between these two mirrored parts, but only relate it between one side and the center line. What we can do here is we go to dimension, and I'll just select, you can either select the center line first and then the element or vice versa. So we'll just pick this up and then we'll pick this up. And you notice it, instead of creating a dimension between the one element and the center line, it creates a relation between the two mirrored elements and their distance apart, which it represents as a diameter in this case. So we can change this to whatever. So maybe we want to change it to 0.100. And, you know, we could do all sorts of stuff with this. We can revolve it around the centerline axis to create a ring. So maybe we're designing a washer of some sort and we just want to set the diameter relationship between both sides of this. You know, there's all sorts of uses for it. Now, say, for example, you did not want to set this relation. Maybe you only did want to reference this side off of the centerline specifically. What you could do is you can click on the element, and we'll actually go ahead and delete this real quick. And we'll start from scratch. We'll go to dimension, left click on the one element, left click on this line. But before you drop the dimension down, we're going to right click and you'll uncheck linear dimension. And when you uncheck this, it'll reference it off of the one side. So if your dimensions quite aren't lining up the way you want to reference them, just right click and look through the little check mark options that you can do to alter how that dimension is taken in the drawing and in the model. So we'll go ahead and drop it like that. So that is your center line element. Okay, so now we have our center points. And for this example, I went ahead and modeled up a machine mount or a foot that screws into a piece of heavy machinery that it sits on the floor with. And what we want to do is we want to cut four holes to bolt this foot to the floor so the machine doesn't move around. And so I want to show you what happens when we use center points and sketch points. So if you look at this plane, I've positioned four points, two of which are center points, which, by the way, center points are the crosshair shape, like you see here, and your sketch points are the dots. So your center points allow the software to position hole elements, you know, when we go to cut a hole into something, directly on that point. Whereas the sketch points, or these dots, are essentially just sketch geometry, or construction geometry rather, that says, hey, you can position elements off of this, but we're not going to actually do anything with it, just like our normal construction elements. So let's take a look at this when we go to cut four holes in this plate. So if I go to finish sketch, I go to my hole option, you'll notice that it automatically defaults two of these holes directly centered to those center points or those crosshairs. This is really important when you're creating really complex hole patterns and you want to do it quickly. You know, you don't want to have to go in and do four separate hole commands and size them differently if they're all going to be the same and in a relatively same position. You know, again, this is good design intent. However, you'll notice that we're missing two of our holes, and that's because these are sketch points and not center points. The software doesn't use these to position the hole pattern. So how we can fix this is if we go back into our sketch, we can highlight the sketch points by, we can just hold control and then click the two. And then we can go up to this little center point button and we can just click that and it converts it to center point. So now if we jump back out of this and go to hole, you'll notice it defaults to all four locations, just how we want it. But let's say, hey, you know, we don't actually want to cut any holes. We just want to use those points to reference other sketch elements off of. Well, we could do the exact opposite of what we just did. We go into the sketch. We can select our points that we want to convert and then just click this option. And it converts them to regular sketch points. Now, you can also automatically set these as center points or sketch points as well by doing the following. So what you could do is you could just hit escape a couple times, make sure you're not in any tools, and you can make sure it's pre-selected. And if you drop points, they're all center points, right? So if I were to drop this in here and you know, get rid of these out here and then go to our hole option, it automatically jumps to all of those holes. It doesn't matter how many I have. However, if I do the opposite, maybe I don't want center points. Maybe I just want to use these as regular points. What I can do is I can deselect that by default, go to point. And now when I drop it, it's just regular sketch construction points. And so if I drop these on here, those new points will not be read as holes. So that is your center point option. Okay, so let's talk about how we can change the appearance of our line elements. So to do that, we go to our format section, and you'll notice that we have a drop down section because of this little arrow facing downwards, and we can left click on that. And you'll notice we have three options in here. And what we can do is we can change the look of a line element by highlighting what we want to change, go to your first option. So right now it's set to default. And we can change it to something different. So maybe we want to do long dash dotted, for example. So now our line element has changed its visual appearance as far as the line type. But let's say we also want to change the color and we want to change how thick or thin the line is. So we go back to format. We can go to this next drop down and let's say we want to make it yellow. So you'll notice that the line elements are now yellow. And finally, let's change the weight of the line. So you go down to this last drop down option and let's scroll down. Let's make it a lot thicker. So we'll go to 0.047. So you'll notice the line thickened up a little bit and we can actually go a little bit larger on that if we want to. So that's how we change the physical appearance of the line. Now, you'll notice there's an option called Show Format. What does Show Format do? Well, what this does is it toggles back and forth between our custom visual representation that we did for our line elements and what the default is. So say, for example, in my sketches, I like to do this dashed line style with a thicker line weight and yellow to represent a certain feature. Maybe I'm not supposed to change the size of this feature, let's say. Well, if someone else was coming back to look at my model and they just want to see it as regular geometry and formatting, they could just go to show format, left click, and now it goes back to the default representation. So you can jump back and forth between those settings. But let's say you accidentally change the formatting of something and you want to get back to the original. What you can do is you can re-highlight your profiles, open up the dropdown again, and you could just scroll all the way back up to the top in each section and go to default. So you could do that for the line type, the line color, and the line weight. So we'll just go up to default, and now we're all back to normal. So that is your show default and how we change the visual representation of your line elements. That concludes this segment of the Autodesk Inventor Part Creation Module, where we took a look at the available 2D sketch format options. Don't forget to like this video, subscribe to my channel, and turn on notifications to stay up to date on future content that will help you reach your goals along your journey. And of course, don't hesitate to leave a comment or reach out via my website contact page and let me know if there's anything else you'd like to learn about or see on this channel. I love sharing my knowledge and experience with the community, and I can't wait to see all of the positive impact you'll create in the world. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you again soon.